measures, and today's our journey will be on the remedial measures. Sir, my voice is audible, sir.
Yes, sir. Yes, sir.
Friends, today our journey under this subject will be on the remedial measures in overcoming the concrete distresses, various forms of distresses on the concrete structure, which has happened due to the environmental effect, due to the carbonation, due to the chloride effect, and due to it may be of poor workmanship, due to design, poor design detailing, due to poor understanding of where the structure is proposed. So there are as and due to corrosion. So there are various factors involved in affecting the concrete durability. So now we are going to travel, and today's session is how we can overcome, what are the remedial measures that are followed, that has been widely followed in practical outside in the industrial practice, what are the various methods that are readily available and adopted in overcoming the distress. Particularly in overcoming the distress means it's not going to be a temporary remedial measure. It's going to be a solution that can enhance, that can enhance a value to the a value addition to the durability of the concrete. As we have discussed in our earlier journey of this subject, that the term durability is to be ensured at all period of time of a concrete structure or a steel structure, so that its design life and service life shall be ensured. So when you the durability of the structure structural component are ensured by timely inspecting, by timely undergoing a maintenance, it may be of routine maintenance, it may be of periodical maintenance, it may be of critical maintenance. So timely undergoing the maintenance processes at various levels in a calendar year, and identifying the problem in the initial stage itself. That's why when the patient goes to doctor for any of the pains, the doctor would after identifying the problem, after mapping the problem of the disease in the patient, the doctor would sometimes used to say, if you could have come up much earlier, we would have done something so that your lifespan may be increased, or it would have been completely removed. But now the time has gone. Now we cannot do anything, sometimes the doctor used to say, or sometimes since you have come up in the very late stage, the lifespan will be very short. Something very that moment when you hear such a moment when the doctor says, the value of timely identifying the problem is going to be a very, very important task in overcoming the distresses. The same it will be applied here in the structures part also. Your patient is your structure. If you are going to play a role of repair and rehabilitation engineer, or if you are going to get an appointment in an industry where they are masters, or they have a business in the repair and rehabilitation, or you are going to play a vital role in the design, where you are going to play a vital role in the construction part. So after understanding all the factors that are going to have an impact on the term durability, when you have a clear picture on the various terms or various factors which will have an impact on the durability, the term durability, you will be, when you come out of your college and you go enter into industry, then you will be in a very comfortable position in overcoming or in developing a very good planning at the earliest stage. So prevention is better than cure. That proverb is going to be applicable for this subject also. Now, friends, this first slide, you will be, you might have went to this site also. This is a broken bridge on Adyar, which you might have, you personally, you might have visited with your friends, or even you might have seen this bridge, broken bridge in many of the movies that you have watched. Now you can see this broken bridge, concrete structure. Say the cover concrete is spilled out, exposing the steel with corrosion. And the color of the concrete has faded. So there are a lot of distresses as this broken bridge has undergone, this broken bridge of concrete element has undergone in the period of time. Now this is another visual of that bridge. So you can see this beam. You can see the pillar, you can see that the deck slab. Now, my dear friend, suppose if this type of structure, either it may be of a residential building or a bridge, if it comes to you, how you will focus it in overcoming this distress? That's what we are going to discuss in this today's journey. Friends, this bridge is being constructed in facilitating for the fishermen's commute between the Besanagar beach to the fishermen's, the another side of the beach. So, but in the year 1977, this bridge has broken due to the water current forces and a cyclonic effect. But in the period, the next subsequent period, from 1977 to this 2020, is almost 44 years. Over a period of time, this bridge has undergone a severe environmental impact on this concrete structure and the distresses of in various forms. It has shown, the concrete structure has shown its pains in expressing its pain in the form of distresses of various forms. Now this is something of a closer view of, you see how severely the corrosion has taken place on the pillar. Even you can see this, the white salt deposition. Even you can see here this drainage spout. Actually the drainage spout, if you provide a drainage spout, the water would have been easily not drip on the bottom surface of the deck. It would have been dripped directly on the river. So my dear friends, each and every element is going to play an important role in ensuring the durability of the concrete. So whenever you come across a salt deposition, or you call it as a leaching effect, which we have discussed in the earlier our session, my dear friends, this calcium carbonate has to be removed. First, we have to, when you are dealing with this type of salt deposition, the first and foremost thing as a repair and rehabilitation engineer, you should identify the source of water dripping. That source has to be cut off permanently. That is, it has to be eliminated permanently. Then you have to completely remove this white salt deposition, which has been deposited on the concrete surface. How to remove this white salt deposition? The salt deposition can be chipped off, or it can be scrubbed completely, or you can wash it with a clean water. Clean water means a potable water, not a salty water. Then you can even brush using a wire brush on the surface of the concrete till the salt deposition has wiped off, and you have to clean it with a clean water, potable water, and make it dry. Or in sometimes it has to be washed with a dilute hydrochloric acid. It is not a concentrated hydrochloric acid, it has to be washed with a dilute hydrochloric acid, so that this white salt deposition are completely wiped off. Then you can apply the treatment process.
That means apply the treatment process means not simply after clean washing it, making it dry, then apply paint. Not like that. We have to estimate how much for this white salt deposition has got the damage inside the concrete. For that purpose only, you have to go for carbonation test, that is sprinkling of phenolphthalein indicator. Okay, my dear friend. Now, my dear friends, repair and rehabilitation measures are, why I have put the word remedial measure means the remedy may be in accordance to the engineer in charge. Here, engineer in charge, the term denotes yourself. Every individual of your classroom is going to play as a role of engineer in charge of the site. So the engineer in charge has to act very fast. So repair and rehabilitation is a serious business. It is a serious task. It is not a very easy task. It is a very painful task. So you, just like how walking on the wooden piece in crossing the river, the same way, more caution in understanding the problem and in developing the scheme, in selecting the material and in implementing each and every step. How this, while crossing this river over a piece of wood, every step is valid, has to be measured. The same way, overcoming the distress in the process of repair and remedial measures, which we call it as a remedial measure, is going to be very, very important. Now, when you see the next, the jaunty roads is just running towards the stem to make a run out of the batsman. Now, how far? See, he would have tried by throwing the ball exactly over the stump, but he hasn't tried. He acted very fast and he has run towards the stem. And not only that, he has not completely run towards the stem. At one point of time, he jumped. He was in the air when he is stumping with the ball. So the same way, you have to, your reaction towards the identifying the problem on the concrete structure and your reaction in mapping the problem, your reaction in understanding the problem, your reaction in developing the scheme, your reaction in implementing the scheme, and your reaction in overcoming the problem permanently on the structure has to be very, very quick with reference to the time you have to run, as how Jaunty Roads here is doing. So it has to be immediately. The timely identify the problem and timely mapping the problem and timely identifying the source of the problem and timely implementing the suitable solution will always prevent the structure in maintaining its durability, and it will meet your design and service life period. The next, whatever the after identifying the problem, timely identifying the problem, mapping the problem, timely implementing, whatever the remedial measures, it may be in the form of repair, only grouting, crack sealing, or chipping of the cover concrete and re-plastering on it, or it may be of rehabilitation. That is, rehabilitation means you are adding value to its strength. You are increasing the strength. Or a combination of both repair and rehabilitation. Whatever the activity that you are going to frame and implement it, just like in the third GIF, how Mr. Dhoni is hitting every ball as to the out of the ground, the same way, whatever the methodology that you are going to implement, it has to meet the durability, ensuring its durability. Every ball has to be hit six by the Dhoni in the cricket match. If the same way, you have to hit it six out of ground. There should not be any repetition of problem. There should not be any recurrence of the problem. In such a way, you have to develop the scheme and implement it. Okay, my dear friend. Now we'll see in the upcoming slides, we will see one by one the various problems and what are the different types of remedial measures. My dear friend, friends, suppose when you come up with a sunken slab, for example, in the bridge, you have an approach slab, a structure. For example, the bridge which is very closer to the your institution, say Pundamali flyover. The flyover from the national highways connecting towards the Pundamali town. When you grow at the upgrade, it will go towards Coimbatore. Now, when the bridge where you are going up in the upgrade towards Pundamali, that is the flyover structure. And I'm just bringing an example which in your day-to-day life you will be used to travel in a college bus or a two-wheelers or in your own vehicle. Now, after the first part where your vehicle is going to climb is the retaining structure, which we call it as a reinforced earth wall type structure. It is not a RCC wall. Now, at the end, the connection between the main flyover component, flyover will be of concrete deck slab, pier cap, pier and open foundation or pile foundation, any type. Now, the connection between these two will be made through the slab, that is approach slab. Suppose if that approach slab will be laid at the bottom of the retained compacted earth wall. Over the earth wall, over the earth fill behind the abutment location, that is the retaining wall structure, that earth will be compacted, and over that a PCC of 150 mm thickness, then over that you will be having a 300 mm thickness of the approach slab. Now, this slab, due to the poor compaction underneath where it is laid, it may settle down. That settlement will reflect in the form of crack formation at the top. Okay. So, whenever we come across such a type of situation, this sunken slab has to be repaired and brought to this original position. But repairing of this, you cannot stop the vehicle and divert it, and the repairing will be you have to completely dismantle it, excavate up to the bottom, then you have to completely recompact it, relaying the earth where it is held. That means sometimes you have to refill it, then compact it properly. Then you have to fill once in PCC and you have to recast it. It is a time consuming process. But we want to come, the traffic flow should not be disturbed. At the same time, we have to implement a quick solution for this. How it can be done? We might have heard the story of a crow running, flying over a house where the pot is being kept. It becomes very thirsty. When it sees down in the pot, the water will be at the bottommost level where it cannot drink. So what it did, it keeps on putting the pebbles or stone pieces into the pot. So the water level rises and it drinks water and it fetches water and overcomes its thirsty. The same way here, you have to be thirsty enough in implementing the remedial measure, quick remedial measure. At the same time, traffic flow should not be disturbed. Because the project may involve in the operation where toll collection should not be disturbed. Okay. So, therefore, the remedial measure has to be very quick enough. At the same time, it should be of permanent. Okay. So, what the same example, how the crow puts so much of pebbles or stones and the water level rises and it fetches, is thirsty by drinking water when the water level rises. The same way, what we have to do, we have to drill holes. The width of the approach slab, the length of the approach slab in the vehicle movement direction will be 3.5 meter and the width will be of the full carriageway width. Okay. So the full, for example, if it is going to be a two lane bridge, means it's going to be 7.5 meter width. If it is going to be three lane, then it's going to be 10.5 or 11 meter or 12 meter outer to outer. So it will be casted fully. Okay, now this over the surface of this slab without dismantling, what we are going to do, we are going to put a 100 mm dia hole drill. We have to drill hole. As I said, 300 mm thick, then bottom 150 mm PCC slab, okay? Then 300 plus 150 with the full depth, the hole has to be drilled. So at every 1 meter center to center, all along the area of the approach slab, this holes has to be drilled completely. Then we have to pour the grouting material of, it may be of cement grout or it may be of lime with lime grout also. So any combination or even fly ash also you can use. That grout material suitably has to be mixed and it has to be poured. Then when you pour on the first, when you pump it on the first hole, how will you identify that at the bottom below the first hole is filled? It will rise just like how the grout material rise and it will overflow in the next nearby drilled hole. Then immediately you have to shift yourself to the next location. And in such a way, you have to completely fill so that automatically the sunken slab will rise, just like how in the story what we have read in our childhood, when you throw stones inside the crow, water level rises. The similar form, this grouted that will make the sunken slab to rise at the top. And when you cure it, automatically it will form, become very hard. So in future, there will not be any subsequent settlement. So this we call it as a mud jacking. How your jack, whenever your vehicle, car or bus got the tire got puncture, what they do, they put a jack and they lift it and they replace. Same way here, it is called as mud jacking because you are adding the grouting material so that the, just like the grouting material acts, act like a jack, it is lifting the sunken slab. That's what has been discussed in picture number 1, 2, and 3. This we practically follow at site, which is given a very good result also. Now we will see a small video. So this is the methodology or repairing methodology for the damage of the concrete with the exposure of corrosion steel. This video will narrate you step by step procedure. So I am trying my best to bring to you the pictorial representation so that for your easy understanding, and when you go out and play an important role in the industry, it will be very easy for you to immediately bring the solution. My dear friends, there are so many companies are available in the market. So in so no need to worry of only, don't fix yourself of only one company product. You can use any company product provided your methodology should be should suit the requirement, what is needed at site, the problem. Friends, earlier it has come as you have to use the material within 1 hour. Okay. That means somewhere it has come, no? Always you have to use clean water, that is potable water. Don't use any salty water. My dear friend, just a moment. I am just. See what they are. How they are mixing the material is through mechanical mixer blade. This is the actually requirement of mixing. This is the correct procedure. Sometimes at site they may not use this type of mechanical mixer blade. They use simply take a small stick and they will in a clockwise direction or anti-clockwise direction, they will mix it. That is, that will not give a good mixture of a uniform mixture of these chemical products. My dear friend, repair and reliability, you are going to deal with the chemicals, okay? Or you are going to deal with the polymers, or you are going to deal with the epoxy. So this mixing of two different products, hardener, primer, everything has to be mixed uniformly, consistently. Consistent has to be there. So when you mix by using a stick, the chemical mixing may not happen uniformly. That will impact your performance of the repairing methodology. There may be a chance for recurrence of the problem. There may be an adverse reaction due to the non-uniformity mixing of the product. So henceforth, always ensure at site when you're dealing with such type of repairing that mixing has to be strictly enforced using mechanical mixture. And most important thing is, whenever you're dealing with such a type of repairing, the first and foremost thing is, when the product comes, you have to check the product, what is brought to site are similar in line with the finalized repair and rehabilitation methodology product, and same company, same brand, then date of manufacturing, what is the expiry date, what is the part life. Part life means when it is opened and when you start mixing, within that particular, some may chemicals, some product has to be mixed and implemented, and it has to be used or consumed within 30 minutes. Some material may be 1 hour, some may be more than that. So as per that manufacturer recommendation, it has to be ensured strictly at site. And for that, the best way is you have to create your own checklist, and you have to put tick mark one by one. Suppose at any point of time you are not happy, try to stop the work and till it matches your actually approved methodology, then you proceed. Because whenever you go to work, they will say you are fighting with the time. So it has to be completed with this today and tomorrow some opening is there, something like that. But when you are compromising the term quality with reference to time measure, then you are yourself questioning the performance of the structural component or the structure as a whole. You are questioning that because of your improper implementation of the remedial measure. Already the member or the structure has shown its pain through its various form of distress. Now you are going to put a medicine over it. That then there should not be any compromise on the quality of giving the medicine in treating that pain or distress of the concrete. Okay, my dear friend. So whenever you involve in such type of activity, you should have your own file containing a checklist, containing the date, time, because the every manufacturer will have a data sheet, technical data sheet. In that, they will give a clear testing parameters results. All are laboratory oriented tests. They will say this, the tensile strength or the compressive strength will reach this much, say 45 newton per meter square or 60 newton or anything, any number at temperature of 25 degree centigrade, 30 degree, because all these products are done in the laboratory in their country. So in your country, what is the temperature, that under what temperature you are going to do, that will decide the strength, that will decide the result of that. So for that, what you have to do when you are doing the repairing, you have to either better prior to repairing start, you have to do some cube casting samples and test the cubes and ensure whether the results 7 days or 28 days results are matching, even 1 day, because your data sheet will have 1 day test results, 1 day, 7 day, and so on. So that results are minimum matching that, or it is more than that. It should not be less than that. If you are finding out some problem, immediately discuss with the manufacturer they will be having their technical team and explain, because in Rajasthan, the temperature, when the activity you are doing, the temperature may be of 50 degrees centigrade. When you are doing in Chennai, the temperature may be 35, or even the summertime, it will reach more than 40. And when you are involved in the night time, the temperature may fall less than 20 also. In Rajasthan, in the temperature at the winter season, it will go near less than 10, 5 degree also. So everything has to be thoroughly study the data sheet. What is the lowest temperature? What is the highest temperature? Then do the sample study, then get a clear confirmation, then you start implementing. That will always help you, my dear friends. There should not be any lump form. Okay. 1 minute only. I'm sorry. Always when you are mixing, we have to wear safety boots, safety shoes, then safety jacket, then glove, gloves, everything. Safety measures has to be strictly enforced at site. So whenever you are, always prefer non-shrinkage product. You can go for curing compound also. And most importantly things, my dear friends, when you're involving in the site, sometimes the contractor may say only one product. If I want to complete that work immediately, I cannot able to mobilize this product because the supply chain is getting affected. It will take time. So can I change my product? In such scenario, you should not say immediately yes. You have to study the credential of that product, where it has been used, previous history. You have to ask the contractor to supply those details and test details, whether it has been attested by any of the reputed institutions, laboratories, or any nationally recognized certified ISO certified industry laboratories. All this history you have to study, then only you have to give a clearance. Okay, and moreover, when it comes to site, suddenly due to the lack of availability, in the off way, you cannot change another different product, even though it is equivalent to this. In the off way of completion, you should not change two different products for the same application, because both are different factory setup and different chemical, they are using chemicals at their own limited closed environment. So we cannot judge their quality. So always use a single component from starting to ending and follow all quality measures. So when you are involved in such type of concrete repairing, surface concrete repairing, then you have to completely remove till you reach the good concrete. Then you see whether the exposed steel is having a corrosion. Then you remove all the corrosion particles. Then you see the diameter, whether the diameter is damaged more than 20% of its original size. If it is happened, then you cut it, replace it with new reinforcement. But when you're replacing, always follow the required lap length and anchorage length. Whenever you are involved in such type of replacement, you have to use always shear connectors. Then you apply anti-corrosive paint, then apply bonding agent, because the new repairing material has to have bond with the parent material. So for that you have to apply a bonding agent. Then you apply it. Before doing the repair, they always wash with a clean water. Okay. This is step-by-step procedure, these slides. Okay, see the replacement in the step 3 bottommost photo. It has been shown. Sometimes you have the opportunity to tie the two bars. sometimes the site condition may not allow you for tying it. In such situation, you have to go for welding also. This slide will brief you about that shear connectors, the welding. Okay. So shear connectors, when you are involved, it has to be penetrated 200 mm inside the parent concrete. So when you are welding, what should be the thickness and what should be the length? That has to be ensured correctly. Minimum it should be of diameter of the reinforcement, a wedge length, you know, sometimes 100 mm or 150 or 300. Even if it is not possible to wet on both sides, you can go for welding on one side also. Then step four. Okay. So whenever you are involved, you have to use air blower. When you are using air blower, wear helmet and mask, glass and safety shoe, safety gloves. Now when you are involved in crack repairing, your crack has to be groove cut like this, like a view, 20 mm by 20 mm. Then you wash with the clean water. Then if you want to close that crack with the PMC mortar or epoxy material, you can close it. Or if you want, if you are planning to fill the, sometimes the crack when you wash after we grout, when you wash it with the clean water, you can see whether the crack has end or still after groove cutting 20 mm also, you are able to see crack means some, that means the crack might have penetrated much deeper. So whenever you come across cracks that are penetrated deeper into the concrete section, then in such cases you have to go for nipple grouting. So you have to go V-groove cut, you have to put the nipples and you have to inject the suitable repairing material. The repair material may be PMC mortar, polymer, modified cementitious mortar or epoxy resin. Epoxy resin will be in the form of like oil. You have to inject it. Whenever you are going to inject it, first you have to clean that surface, grind it. So surface preparation is playing a very vital role in ensuring the performance. Okay, my dear friend. Now we will see a small video how the V groove cut. Sir, are you kekkira da? Vignesh sir, are you able to hear the audio?
Yes sir.
Okay. So whenever you are seeing a crack, first you map it, then you start the activity. Fine. So now we will see after V groove cutting how the repairing has been done. So when we look at the repairing methods visually, it will enhance or facilitate us to understand very easily so that you will not forget when you are exposed to that such type of environmental condition in the industry, when you come out of your college. So this is a small explanation of how to treat the cracks by using a resin filling or cracks even. Now, my dear friends, the next case is, this is the view of a pedestrian subway. Where in Chennai, you might have been seeing many subways where pedestrians. Now, during the rainy season, the water level may rise at the backside. The water level may rise at the side wall where the earth is filled. So when the water level rises, the water may, when the, because since the concrete is a porous material, a fine crack or a small honeycomb anywhere present, which you might have not seen in the front face, but at the back, if there are any small openings, this water table rises during monsoon season, will try to come inside and you will be seeing water logging inside the subway. Now, whenever you see water logging in the subway, then the pedestrian subway will become unusable during the monsoon season because of the water logging or stagnant. Now, in such cases, generally during the construction time, what they will do, because all subway are a underground structure, that is, they are going below the original ground level. So what they will do during construction time, they will use they pour the car, excavate it, and they will construct the box type structure, and it will be wrapped all around with the waterproofing membrane sheet. But what is happening is, when they, even though they paste it, when they refilling, backfilling the earth, the excavated material into the side portion, what happens, this waterproofing membrane sheet got damaged, getting damaged. And during monsoon, when the water rises, it finds its own path through this and getting inside the subway and resulting in water logging or water stagnant. That is why, and sometimes they may not use waterproofing membrane itself. And even at the construction joint, they will be using the water stopper, so that the joints are tightly packed so that the water will not enter inside. So therefore, whenever we come across such a type of problem, water logging, the best solution, which in my earlier session, we have discussed about IRCSP 40, guideline for repair, strengthening and rehabilitation of concrete bridges or structure. See, the code says very clearly, any problem with whenever you come across a water dripping in a concrete structure, the best solution is to seal the water dripping or water leakage permanently. Is it has to be treated not with PMC grout or not with epoxy. The permanent solution will be of treat with PU injection. The letter P and U. P stands for poly, U stands for urethane, polyurethane. Polyurethane is a chemical resin that, when it reacts with water, due to it will undergo hydrophobic reaction. Hydrophobic. This PU injection material will not dissolve in the water. When the water touches this PU injection material, this PU will develop, due to its hydrophobic reaction, it develops a hard bound elastic foam material. So this material, hard bound elastic material, foam material, that will prevent the ingress of water inside, furthermore inside, and they will seal it completely. You can
Students kindly wait.
Sorry friends, there was some network issue, I think. I'll just is this slide sir?
Yes sir, yes sir.
In this slide again?
Yes sir, yes sir.
Friends, so whenever you come across a water leakage or water dripping, water stagnant problem inside the subway, the first and foremost thing is, sir, whether I described about the chemical name, that and all.
Yes, sir, you have explained, sir. Yes, sir, yes, sir, you have explained it.
Okay, that up to that point, it is clear, correct?
Yes, sir.
Okay, fine. So now, my dear friend, so when we come across such a problem, so identify or map the locations to which the water is dripping on along the length of the structure component. Then map it. Now, after mapping it, then you have to start the process of implementing the PU injection. Okay. So this is the photograph view of water stagnating due to the water leakage or dripping inside the sub. So even though there will be a separate pit for water collection and you can sump will be there, you can pump it, but still if water is getting stagnated for inside the subway, and when the subway becomes not usable by the public, then immediately you have to jump in and put a stop, you have to eradicate the water dripping permanently. Okay. Now, as I explained, the PU, polyurethane, is the best solution for in overcoming the water leakage problem in the concrete structure. Even in the rock also, this polyurethane, whenever, for example, in the inside the tunnel, the tunnel will be having a lined tunnel, unlined tunnel. All our metro, Chennai metro tunnels running from Saidapetta towards Chennai Central Station, up to Chennai are all underground, which are running along the mount road. So all are lined tunnel. Lined tunnel means it be completely, it will be of shotcreted and a concrete will be provided. Whereas unlined means only the rock, it will be drilled, blasted, and the rock formation will be there. And over that, it will be shotcreted. That's all. You will be seeing so many undulations of rock cuttings visually. After shotcrete, it will not be lined. So in that case also, if you come across sometimes the water leakages in the rock, then this PU can be injected. So PU, polyurethane, is a very good chemical compound which is a permanent solution. My dear friend, there are so many companies. We have Sika, BASF, Normet, Force Rock. Many other companies are coming up with this polyurethane. So any suitable company product, but the product should be of polyurethane. It is something like whether you are intake, for whenever your temperature is high,
your intake may be of crocin, dolos, or any other medicine, but the chemical component of that each product will be of paracetamol. The same way, any company product you may use, but the product should be of contain polyurethane component. See, whenever that it in here, we went with the normal. This product is normal. Normal. This normal polyurethane has A and B component. A will come in a separate container and B will come in separate. This A and B has to be mixed uniformly and it has to be injected. Now the mixing cannot be done in a container by mixing A and B and a mechanical mix. We have a special gun through which A and B will be supplied at a uniform rate, and in the gun itself it will be mixed in the ratio of 1:1 and it will be applied as a unique component called polyurethane. Now to apply that, you have to use mechanical packer. This packer will be having a controllable valve at the end. This packer has to be inserted inside the selected location where the chemical PU has to be injected. Now to fix that, you have to put a drill hole. Now this is the view where this packer is fixed. Now, as I told that it is having a controllable valve, when you open the valve, you see the water is oozing out. That means you are correctly mapped the location of water dripping, and you can also see the water table has raised more than that level. So the mapping is correct. The location of injection is also going to be correct. Now, when this PE is going to react with this water, it will going to form a hard bound elastic material that will prevent further in future further penetration inside. And not only you are going to prevent the water locking, you are also going to prevent the corrosion of steel which are embedded inside the concrete. Now this is the mechanical component where, see this, you are having A and B separate container where two tubes are inserted in both A and B separately. See here. Now, my dear friends, when you are inserting A and B in a first batch, batch one will have one set A and B container. Now, when this is over, then the next batch will come, you have to insert same way. Now, suppose in the first batch, you are inserting one tube in A and another in B. Suppose in the subsequent batch, if you are mixing A tube into B, B to A, then the chemical reaction will be totally different and you will not get a fruitful result. Because already inside the tube, A component will be there. Now suddenly B comes and react with A, then A with B, then the total chemical reaction will be adverse. So always you have to follow a very correct, a qualitative measure. So to avoid that confusion, these tubes are winded with the color tapes, green and red. So green means A or red means B, or red means A, green means B. That will be followed from starting to end completely without any confusion during the process of injection. Now, as I said, this is the gun. So A, suppose A is coming in this, B is coming in this tube. Now it will be mixed here in the ratio of 1:1, and through this gun, it will be mixed uniformly as a PU injection, A plus B in the ratio of 1:1. See how the gun is fixed in the mechanical packer, and now the process of injection is starting. Now before injecting, you have to flush it so that any foreign matter present inside the tubes A and B are in both tubes or in any one of the tubes, that will be washed out completely and only this material will be there. Then you can start the process. Now you see the process of injecting. So material will be injected in this direction. See, my dear friends, you are injecting here, and the chemical, since it is a non-shrinkage chemical, PU, even it can fill the crack width which are less than 0.1 mm also. They have, even the hairline crack also will be filled by, because it is a low viscous solution. Okay, so you can see here, you are filling inside in this direction. After filling up all the cracks, all the voids, it is coming out at this location, because here also there are openings which you may not see through naked eye. So that means when the solution is coming out at the nearby location, that means it indicates that whatever the voids or cracks or porous material, pores are behind that supply of injecting point that are completely filled. That is the indication. Now, during the process of injection, it is always a good engineering practice to collect the sample directly from the gun. And when you collect the sample in the container, you have to write the batch number from which the container it is collected, the date, time, and the location of the packer. The packers will be the points which will be marked as 1, 2, 3, 4, and so on. So from which point you are collected, everything detail has to be there. Date, time, batch number, then packer number, everything. And how much, what is the sample container number also has to be written in the permanent marker by the engineer in charge. Now, when you add water inside the collected sample, you can see a hard bound foam material formation. This is called hydrophobic reaction. Now you see my injection point is here at the bottom, but since it is a low viscous fluid and even it can fill the cracks lesser than very hairline crack also, you can see that means it is traveled, it has traveled against the gravitational force, and all the pores or hairline cracks inside this concrete section are filled, and you are able to see it is rippled back. That means this area, the area behind this injected point, are completely sealed. So next time, even though when a water table rises, this water will not drip inside, and you have put permanently a stoppage to the water leakage. You can see this. Now, suppose when you are involved in this type of activity, A and B are two different containers. Sometimes if there are any small quantum of material is retained in the first batch, and when you're bringing the second batch, you should not mix that first batch into the second. Never have that practice. My dear friend, this 1 kilogram or 1 liter of injection material is costing more than 3,000 rupees. Okay. So then your interest should not be saving the quantum of liquid injected. Your interest should be, whenever you involve in the repair and rehabilitation activity, your interest should be in putting a cutoff to the problem or put a permanent solution or permanent treatment. So therefore, saving a small quantum is not going to add any value, because when you mix the first batch in the second mix, we don't know how the batches are coming, because it is coming from the manufacturer plant. Sometimes if any adverse chemical reaction happens, which is not giving a good result, because all these chemical reactions are going to happen behind the concrete wall, which you are not able to see. Therefore, avoid such type of activity at site when you are involved. Now, after completing this, this package has to be removed and it is to be completely sealed. And at the end of every batches, the engineer in charge, if you are going to be engineer in charge of this site, you have to put you have to mark empty and the date of completion with your signature and with your contractor, supervisor in charge, everybody, everything, and it should be kept separately. Now, next material is repairing and rehabilitation is through FRP. FRP means fiber reinforced polymer material. See, FRP is something which is very easy to implement it. And it adds more value in terms of strengthening, in bringing up the original strength and ensuring its durability and its serviceability. And this is very easy to implement at site. It will be just coming like this material will come like in the form of the rolling sheet. When you go to the cloth store, you will be seeing the pant bit or a shirt bit, how it is will be rolled in the wooden piece. The same way it will be in the rolled form. Okay, then you have to paste it over the concrete member where you have to go for a strengthening. Okay. So it is of high tensile continuous fibers oriented in desired direction. These FRP materials are coming in the form of unidirectional as well as bidirectional fibers. So it is you have to decide. And always better to have a bidirectional fibers for better result. This fiber reinforced polymers methodology will enhance the shear capacity, will enhance the tensile capacity, will enhance the compression capacity, and to the end, it will add more value to in terms of strength, structural stability, so that the structural component or the structure as a whole will be protected from the failure. But the most important thing is in the implementation is it has to be implemented very precisely. That should not be, because it is coming like a cloth. You are going to paste it over the required member where the strength is to be added. So there should not be any sharp edges, and the surface preparation is going to play an important role. Then first layer will be a primer. Then you have to go leave for a suitable curing period as per the manufacturer prescription. Then you have to apply the saturant. Then you have to, when the saturant is in a fluid state, say non-sticky, just like how when you paste a cinema poster on the wall, they will put some glue in the form of maida, no? How that formation, when it comes to that non-sticky form, you have to test it with your forefinger and your thumb and test the consistency. Then immediately it has to be wrapped. One fellow will wrap it, the another fellow will put the roller brush so that it will uniformly wrap, and there should not be any air voids, there should not be any sharp edges, and there should not be any wrinkles. Okay. This slide will give you details of advantages. So it is more helpful towards shear, tension, compression. These are different kinds of FRP system, carbon, glass, aramid, and it is up to the engineer in charge. Depending upon the usage, depending upon the cost, you have to choose the suitable fiber reinforced polymers. And you have to implement it as per the need. It is coming in both sheet form as well as it is coming in the form of laminates. Suppose, my dear friends, when you feel that deck slab where there is a reinforcement shortages, then in such cases you can add this FRP laminates, which is going to act in the form of steel reinforcement function that will be pasted on the top or at the bottom as per the problem in the respective concrete member. So it is coming in both laminate form. That is laminate strips. Now this slide will describe about the mechanical properties. All these details will be readily available in the respective data sheet of the manufacturer. Now we will see a small video in understanding why this wrapping, how is important. This video will enhance you, facilitate you to understand why we have to go for FR. Friends, if you have any doubt, you can put your questions in the chat box. In the meantime, I'll try my best to answer your queries. So one is without wrapping, and the another cylinder is with wrapping. First, they are testing with a non. There are no wrapping has been done. Yeah, unwrapped cylinder. So then now next sample with the wrapped. Friends, next. So now you have understood how this wrapping FRP system is adding more value in terms of strengthening. It may be of compression, tension, shear, or any form of, in any way, the strength can be added to the respective member. Now, friends, now if you want to add the strength in terms of flexure or shear, the direction of wrapping material is very, very important. So that has to be ensured by the engineer, by yourself, in which form, whether you are going to add value to, in terms of shear, means you have to wrap perpendicular to the component. If you are going to be add in the flexure form, you have to wrap in parallel to the component. Okay, so the direction or the orientation of wrapping is going to be important task, which has to be decided by the engineer in charge, or that is yourself. Now, same way, it not only this component is going to help in adding the value to the strength of the member, it also, in terms of problem, whenever you come across a problem in the compression member, there also it is can be applied and it will add value. So therefore, the orientation is very, very important. This is a pictorial representation. The orientation, in which orientation you are using, that will add value to the respective terms, shear or flexure. Similarly, in terms of slab, whether you are going to add value in the bottom or at the top. Now we will see another video how these laminates has to be are used and fitted. Okay, this all this my presentation to you, my dear friends, is going to be video and picture, so that you will not forget very easily. And when you go in the next, after 4 months of your final semester, whatever the whenever you come across any problem, immediately these videos and presentation, I feel strongly that it will come in front of your eyes, and you can choose the best one as per your need. And you will not be feeling alone, that you are not aware of the treatment process, you are not aware of the materials, you are not aware of methodologies. Friends, don't worry that this is of a bridge or anything. Bridge or building, beam function is flexure, pier function is compression. The same principle in both bridge and buildings. So principles cannot be changed. So therefore, you can use this laminates in buildings also in accordance to the value addition, shear or tension or compression. So how these stirrups are anchored from the beam into the slab in a T-beam, if you see, the same way these laminates should also be anchored inside the slab. The surface has to be prepared well. Then the preparation of the material, substrate, the component. See, the preparation methodology will be given in the manufacturer data sheet itself. So you have to follow strictly that. All these laminates and FRP sheets should be protected from the sunlight, because it will the UV rays, it has to be protected from the UV rays. So therefore, it has to be painted externally after fixing all these laminates and FRP sheets. It has to be painted externally with the UV protective. That is why whenever the product comes to the site, it should not be exposed to the sunlight. It has to be covered completely. Even sometimes you can choose a project by using FRP study in your lab. Even you can study the cube which you are casting in a concrete tube. That itself can be studied, comparative study of FRP with a non-FRP concrete strength parameters. You can do an experiment in your lab and get a clear picture how it is going to add value. So now the whole activity is completed. Now you have seen these laminates usage in adding value to the shear. Now, how to repair in terms of slab. Suppose in the slab at the top, you want to improve the strength. In such case, you cannot stop the function of the component, and you cannot remove, chip off all the cover concrete and replace it with. So the best way is you can add value by using FRP laminates. That's what we are going to see. CFRP means carbon fiber reinforced polymer. They are using the cover meter. So the activity is completed. Fine. So now we have seen the strengthening using FRP method. Now the next method will be of steel plate bonding. The steel plate bonding also add value in terms of strength with respect to flexure, shear. This is another video in with reference to steel plate bonding methodology. One second.
Construction process of HM steel bonding.
Sir, audio is clear, na?
No, sir. It's not able to hear, sir.
Okay.
It's slightly. It's...
1 minute. Friends, whenever you are going to be involved with reference to this type of methodology, the steel plates will be anchored into the parent concrete. So when you are anchoring it, this anchor should not cause any damage or disturb to the reinforcement inside. That's why you are being always advised to scan it by using cover meter, identify the location, and the anchored holes should be drilled in such a way that it is far away from the reinforcement provided.
Drill hole to setting out, then plant chemical anchor.
Friends, you have seen the chemical anchor yellow color in the video. This chemical grouting is nowadays available in the form of tablet form. Okay, that you can drill it and insert it.
Surface. Flatten the plates. Clean surface with acetone.
So the
according to ratio. Stir the adhesive in low speed till it is and with even color. Apply the mixed adhesive onto the surface of the concrete structure and steel plate surface in the same time. Adhesive on the surface of steel plate should be thicker and thinner on sides. Bond steel plates onto the concrete substrate. Keep plate surface flat and smooth in cross sections. Bending or pull of steel plate is not allowed.
So you cannot allow the bending of the steel plate. So when you would tighten the bolt, it should be tightened firmly so that the it will have a strong bonding between the parent material and the steel plate. So you have to knock it so that any hollow sound are heard or not. So finally, you have to apply anti-corrosive paint to protect the steel plate. Okay, my dear friends. So this is another methodology, steel plate bonding or steel plate anchor. Now next method is jacketing. It is a common methodology which you might have also heard, and for any strengthening part of beams, columns, the most popular method of for strengthening of concrete building elements or even a concrete bridge element will be of jacketing. So the purpose is the same, to have a shear increment, increase the flexure strength and increase the concrete confinement. Now we will see a small video of about this jacketing. See, I am trying my best to bring every methodology, all the methods which are practiced in the industry even today also, in the form of videos for better understanding for the upcoming engineers like you. Okay. And finally, this presentation also will be shared to your sir. There is no voice, only written. Instructions are given in the video. Students, any friends, any doubt, please feel free to raise in the chat box if you have. I am ready to clarify it. See, friends, when you are fixing a shuttering, it may be a wooden board or it may have a steel plate, but you have to be very careful in fixing so that the quantum of concrete that you are going to fill it, it should not come out easily. So whatever you have followed on the one side, the same procedure and has to be followed on the opposite side of the column also. So finally the jacketing has been completed. So this is the video which will help you to understand easily the concept or method of jacketing of a column or a beam. My dear friends, nowadays jacketing, since it has its own detailed sequence of operation and skill labors, now the whenever we involve in terms of strengthening, we always used to prefer FRP. It's very easy to handle, and the damage to the existing and the workmanship and the time consuming is also very, very minimal. Now this is the photography of jacketing. Now this the upcoming slides, 3 to 4 slides, will give a photographical explanation of how to seal the cracks, step 1, step 2, step 3, step 4. It is a photographical explanation for a better and easy understanding, which we have seen this sequence of operation in sealing the cracks in the video format in the earlier slide also. Now next, how to protect our concrete surface from the water, from the particularly in the multi-story building flats, the toilets, below the tiles will be having a concrete floor. That concrete floor is also being protected from the waterproofing membrane, water leakages. So how they are protected is, because when the water leak or drips inside the concrete slab or any of the concrete member, it leads to questioning the durability of the concrete as well as the steel reinforcement embedded inside. So it will lead to corrosion. That is why in many of the flats, because the water leakage from the roof slab, from the toilet slab are quite common because of poor insulation of waterproofing membrane or not maintaining it properly also, or not attending the problem correctly in understanding the source. Now this photograph shows there are two ways. One is applying the waterproof membrane in the form of mat, or another form is liquid form also. Now first we will see about the mat. This mat will be available in a 3mm or even 6mm mat, which even in the deck, the bridge deck, what you see in the black top, bitumen concrete black top surface on the deck, below that the concrete deck is also been protected from the water because it is open to sky during the rain monsoon season. The water, even though we have a very good drainage arrangement also, BC, the black top surface, what you're seeing at the BC bitumen concrete is a wearing surface. Below the wearing surface, because the bridge deck is undergoing wear and tear continuously due to the movement of vehicles. So the concrete deck surface should be protected from this continuous wear of the vehicle movement. So you are providing a bitumen concrete surface. Now, this concrete surface should also be protected from the water dripping inside or during the monsoon season. Even in the multi-story building, the roof slab, the toilet floor slab also should be protected. So what they're doing, one is putting a water mat, proofing membrane in the form of mat. How this mat will be applied? The water mat, which is applied in the form of 3mm or 6mm thick, this will be applied on a torch heat and it will be laid over the concrete surface, and because of this heat it will stick very firmly, and you have to roll on the top so that it will firmly stick over the concrete surface. But before applying this mat, the concrete surface should be completely prepared properly. There should not be sharp edges, there should not be any undulations, there should not be any broken edges, so or any reinforcement. Everything should be properly prepared and the surface should be very smooth and uniform. Then you have to apply this mat, just like it will come in the roll. You have to apply heat at the bottom of the mat and you have to roll it firmly so that it sticks firmly on the concrete surface. This is one form of applying waterproofing membrane. You can see here. Now, suppose even after placing this waterproofing, you are getting water leakage. That means the waterproofing membrane, either it may be got damaged during the installation or the surface may not be prepared properly, and the waterproof membrane may not be get firmly stick or bonded with the concrete surface. You can see this in the bottom in this photo. So surface preparation and properly installing it as per the procedure should be ensured at site by the engineer in charge like you. Now next method is liquid waterproofing membrane. So this slide will help you to understand what are the performance requirements for waterproofing. Long and effective light, high bond strength to the deck, effective crack bridging. Even this liquid waterproofing membrane, even if there are any airline cracks which you cannot see, this liquid waterproofing will fill it and it will prevent the moisture penetration. Applicable all year around, there are no restrictions. Are able to carry load after 1 hour. So within a period of 1 hour of application, you can put the BC and you can allow the load in the bridge, or even in most of the multi-story buildings nowadays, they are preferring this liquid waterproofing membrane in the slab as well as in the toilet floor slab. And able to resist side damage, easily repairable, adhesion to hard surfacing, and it is waterproof. Now it has, this slide will describe about the components of liquid waterproofing. Hard surfacing, tack coat, you have first coat, second coat, then primer. Okay. Each membrane will be of different colors to different, since it is in the form of liquid, every component of the liquid waterproofing will be of different color to differentiate it from one part component to another. First, surface perforation. The next, you have to apply primer. This application of primer can be applied either wire brush or by using a jet, a spray. Now, second, after applying a primer, a suitable curing time has to be followed as per the manufacturer recommendation. Even it may have 30 minutes or 6 hours or 2 hours, whatever is given, it has to be strictly ensured. Next, you have to apply first coat of waterproofing membrane. This is in first primer is in colorless. Next, yellow color that shows the first coat. Then the second coat of waterproofing membrane that is in the liquid form. It will be in the form of white. So between first coat and second coat, the curing time has to be followed very strictly. The next, finally, before applying, suppose if you are applying this over the deck, bridge deck, you have to apply tack coat over the first and second coat, which is in the orange color. So every layer is of different color to indicate which component of the liquid waterproofing membrane you are applying, whether you are applying primer coat, whether you are applying a first coat, whether you are applying a second coat, or whether you are applying tack coat. If it is going to be of all of uniform color, then there will be a lot of confusion. Sometimes the workman, the contractor may say, I have applied, if everything is yellow color, he may say, I applied two coats. You see, the color is yellow. He may say, I have applied tack coat, the color is yellow. But unfortunately, he may not apply it. But if it is going to be of different color, each layer, it will be very easy and value addition to the owner. And even for the engineer in charge also. Now you can apply BC, bituminous concrete, in the bridge deck. Even in the residential buildings, liquid waterproofing membrane is well preferred. Then after applying BC, within 1 hour, of tack coat, you can apply a BC and then it can be open to traffic. So you can see this left hand side carriageway. If it is, see, orange color, that means the tack coat is applied. Then it is ready for, that means primer is applied, first coat yellow, second coat white, then third, then fourth is tack coat orange color, then it is applied. Whereas in the right hand side, you can see colorless. So that means only primary is applied. Now BC you can over. Now this slide will describe about the benefits of the liquid waterproofing. Speed of application, weather tolerance, then environmental friendly, resistance to elevated surfacing temperature. It is able to resist the damage from any ballast, accommodation of surface texture, high bond strength, then weather tolerance, unique on site quality assurance program, speed of repair, anything. Suppose your toilet floor is getting leakage, and whatever water leakage that can be identified only by your resident who is living below your floor. He may give you a complaint. I'm getting water leakage in my hall roof slab. That means the water probably may be dripped from the toilet roof slab, and it is finding its own path and wherever it is having, you are it is able to see a hairline crack or porous, you can see the water, only the water deposition, moisture present, or a dripping will happen. So the source is from the toilet of the upper floor, or the source may be from the roof slab. Through the column beam joint, it may pass down over a continuous period of time, and the lower floors, you can see the water dripping, leakage, or moisture on the wall, or on the roof slab, or on the floor slab. So therefore, the treatment should be, you have to arrest the source. Not if you simply apply a water treatment by putting a PU or epoxy treatment by arresting the crack on the location where dripping is happening, then the water will find the another location where it can easily penetrate outside. But the source water leakage from the toilet floor slab is not treated in time. So what will happen? The water will keep on dripping. Finally, the steel will get corrode. Then you will see cracks, then spalling. Then the treatment remedial measure will be very, very costly. So henceforth, even that is why the tiles, in between tiles, there are gaps, because when under high, the temperature, these tiles will expand and it will pop out. Sometimes in your residential buildings, you may come across a problem of that floor tiles popping out. That means because of the temperature, because of the joints, width is not maintained properly. Nowadays, they are going with a very small, minor joints. If you see your old house, your grandfather parents' houses, the floor tiles, they may use mosaic. There, the joint width will be of bigger size. That means it will be able to resist the temperature. The tiles will not pop out. And when this gap in between two tiles gaps are not filled, what will happen? The water or the moisture will easily penetrate inside. It will affect your reinforcement, leading to corrosion. So finally, friends, we have come to an end of this today's journey on remedial measures. So even we are living in still in this pandemic period, always develop friendship with fruits and vegetables, eat more healthy foods, maintain your immune system in protecting yourself. You have to protect yourself. You cannot expect somebody will come and increase your immune system. Expose yourself to the sunlight, increase your vitamin D, okay, and eat more vegetables and fruits of your taste, and develop the friendship so that you can have a very healthy life. Your health is in your hand. God bless everyone. Thanks for this once again a wonderful opportunity in meeting all through this journey of remedial measures through various methods. Thank you, sir. Thank you, friends.
Thank you so much, sir.
Any doubt, any clarification, friends, please, you can ask me. I'll try my best to clarify it. Any queries?
Students, we can ask you if there is any doubt. Students, if you have any doubt, you can ask.
Fine, sir. I think.
Yes, sir.
I hope I have reached my best in explaining the each remedial measures for a better understanding of our upcoming engineers.
Okay, thank you, sir.
This presentation, I will share it to you, sir.
Okay.